Hello friends, welcome to my channel. Today I am going to teach you all about Lac Operon. To begin with, I will first explain you what is an operon. An operon is a functional part of the DNA which consists of three main components: the promoter, the operator and the structural genes. The structural genes in an operon are clustered together, present on the same DNA molecule adjacent to each other. And all of the structural genes in an operon are under the control of a single promoter, which means that if RNA polymerase comes and binds to this promoter and initiates transcription, it will result into the transcription of all the structural genes which are present downstream of this promoter to give you an mRNA. As you can see, in this single mRNA molecule, there is a protein coding region for the structural gene A, B as well as C. Such an mRNA which has more than one protein coding region is called a polycystronic mRNA, which is a characteristic feature of prokaryotes, as against eukaryotes which have monocystronic mRNA. Monocystronic mRNA is the one which has only one protein coding region, which on translation will yield only one protein. So this polycystronic mRNA on translation will give protein A, protein B and protein C. Mostly, the products of the structural genes of the operon are involved in a single pathway. For example, the pathway could be resulting into the metabolism of a nutrient, for example sugar, or it could be a pathway which is used for the synthesis of nutrient, example amino acid. Okay, so if in the cell there is a need for the functioning of that particular pathway, it is important that the products of all the structural genes of the operon need to be present at that time. And if the pathway need not be functional at that time in the cell, then the structural gene products are of no use and therefore they have to be switched off at that time. So this is what exactly the operon does. The operon brings about a regulated expression of the structural genes and lead to the expression of these genes only when the products of these genes are needed in the cell. So it is quite economical for the cell. So how does this operon brings about this regulation? It does so with the help of this operon element called the operator. So let us see how this operator regulates the expression of the structural genes. It does so with the help of another gene which is called the regulatory gene. This regulatory gene could be present adjacent to the operon, or it could be a part of the operon, or it could be present further away from it. So it doesn't matter. It's not necessary that it has to be present as a part of the operon. Okay. So this regulatory gene is under the control of a constitutive promoter. A constitutive promoter is one which is always on, which means that the transcription from this promoter will always take place in the cell, resulting into the formation of an mRNA, which on translation will give you regulator. So just remember that since it is a constitutive promoter, the product of this regulatory gene, that is a regulator, will always be present in the cell. The regulator could be of two types: the repressor and the activator. Repressor, as the name suggests, it brings about repression, that is inhibition of the transcription of the structural genes. So how does this repressor do so? It does so by binding to the operator. So once this repressor goes and binds to the operator, RNA polymerase cannot bind to the promoter. And therefore, you see repression, that is no transcription of the structural genes which take place. But somehow, if the repressor detaches from the operator, then you will have derepression. Derepression means removal of the repression, or you can say there is activation of the transcription which takes place. Okay. The other type of regulator is activator. Activator, as the name suggests, will bring about the activation of the expression of the structural genes. But mind you, this activator does not bind to the operator. It binds to another site which is called the activation site, and brings about the expression of these structural genes. Okay, so now now that you know the overview of what is an operon, we will now discuss Lac Operon. Lac operon was the first operon to be studied and described by the Nobel laureates Francois Chekhov and Jacques Monod in Escherichia coli. It is an operon which is present in E. coli and many other enteric bacteria. And if glucose is not present in the cell and if lactose is present in the surrounding environment of the cell, then the Lac operon structural genes get expressed and the products help in the transport and the metabolism of this sugar, lactose. Since the entire Lac operon revolves around lactose, now I'll explain you what is lactose made up of. Okay, lactose is a disaccharide which is made up of two simple sugars or two monosaccharides, beta D galactose and beta D glucose. I will explain you what does this beta mean. If you remember, galactose and glucose both are aldoses. That is, they have an aldehyde functional group in their molecule. So for your reference, I've shown here the linear structure of glucose, wherein in the first carbon atom you have aldehyde as the functional group, C double bond O H. Okay, so and the C double bond O is called the carbonyl group. So when this linear structure is converted into the cyclic form, the carbon atom in the cyclic form, which is derived from this carbonyl carbon, is called the anomeric carbon atom. So in the cyclic structure of glucose as well as galactose, the carbon atom number 1 that you can see here and the carbon atom number 1 over here has been derived from this carbonyl group, and therefore the carbon atom number 1 are called anomeric carbon atom. Okay, now depending upon the spatial arrangement of the atoms around this anomeric carbon atom, you can get two types of molecules, alpha anomer and beta anomer. If the OH group is present upwards, that is above the plane of this ring, then it is called a beta anomer. And if the OH group is present below the plane of the ring, that is downwards, then it is called alpha anomer. So now I hope you all have understood what does this beta mean. Okay, now lactose is formed when there is a linkage, that is a glycosidic bond that takes place between the carbon atom number 1 of galactose and the carbon atom 4 of glucose. And glycosidic bond is formed when there is a condensation reaction which takes place. Condensation is nothing but there will be removal of water. So water, how, from where will water be removed? You can see the OH from here and the H from here will be removed as water, and then the bond so formed is called a glycosidic bond. And since the carbon number atom 1 and 4 are involved, it is called a lactose has a beta 1,4 linkage. Okay, such a molecule which is formed wherein a sugar molecule is bonded to another sugar molecule, or for that matter any other molecule, via a glycosidic linkage is called a glycoside. And a glycoside which contains galactose is called a galactoside. Therefore, lactose is also called beta galactoside. Okay. Now, this is the structure of the Lac operon. As you can see, it consists of the promoter, the operator, and three structural genes, Lac Z, Lac Y, and Lac A. Okay. So promoter is the region where the RNA polymerase will bind and bring about the transcription of these three structural genes, forming a polycystronic mRNA. Okay, so this LacZ gene on translation will give you beta galactosidase. Beta galactosidase has the following functions. It brings about the conversion of lactose into an isomer of lactose which is called allolactose. Okay, once allolactose is formed, this molecule is very important. Please remember this, that when lactose enters the cell, it gets converted into allolactose using this enzyme beta galactosidase. And beta galactosidase also brings about the hydrolysis of lactose and allolactose into the constituent monosaccharides beta D glucose and beta D galactose. Okay, so how does this happens? Let us see. First, I will show you what is the difference between lactose and allolactose. The only difference is in the linkage. As you can see, in allolactose, instead of the beta 1,4 linkage, which is seen in lactose, you have the beta 1,6 linkage. Okay, so this is the carbon atom number 1, and this is the carbon atom 6 of glucose. So there is a linkage between the carbon atom number 1. Okay, glycosidic linkage. So that's the only difference between allolactose and lactose. And then how does galactosidase brings about the formation of galactose and glucose from lactose? It does so by hydrolyzing this or breaking this glycosidic bond. As we just saw that a glycosidic bond is formed by removing water. Okay, so if you want to break a glycosidic bond, you will have to add water. So this is what the galactosidase do. So how is water added? You can see OH over here and H over here gets added, and simply this bond is broken down. Okay, giving you beta D galactose and beta D glucose. Okay, now the next gene, that is the Lac Y gene, it encodes for a protein called the beta galactoside permease. As the name suggests, it permits. What does it permit? It permits lactose to enter into the cell. That is, it is a transporter of lactose, and it brings about the transportation of lactose actively. Actively means energy is spent in transporting lactose into the cell. Okay, so this is a representative diagram that I've made of beta galactoside permease. It is a symporter. What do you mean by a symporter? A symporter is a transporter which simultaneously transports two things into the cell. As you can see here, with every one lactose that is transported by this permease, one proton is also transported into the cell. Thus, it is an active transport because a proton motive force PMF is used in transporting lactose. Okay, now the third gene, that is the Lac A gene, encodes for a protein called the thiogalactoside transacetylase. As the name suggests, it transfers an acetyl group from acetyl CoA to beta galactosides. It mostly transfers the acetyl group to non-metabolizable beta galactosides which enter into the cell. Okay, so it does a detoxification of the otherwise toxic non-metabolizable beta galactosides which enter into the cell into a non-toxic form. It doesn't have any role to play as such in the metabolism of lactose. Now let us see how does Lac Operon brings about the regulation of the expression of the structural genes. Okay, so it does so with the help of this regulatory gene which is present adjacent to the Lac Operon, and it is under the control of a constitutive promoter, which means this promoter is always on and it will transcribe the regulatory gene always in the cell into mRNA. On translation, will give you the regulator called the LACI repressor protein. Okay, now this LACI repressor protein will go and bind to the operator region of the Lac Operon. Since it goes and binds to the operator region of the Lac Operon, RNA polymerase cannot come and bind to the promoter. And as it cannot bind to the promoter, there will be no transcription of the LacZYA gene that will take place. Okay, but occasionally this LACI repressor protein interaction with the operator weakens and it detaches from the operator. Okay, and at that time the RNA polymerase comes and binds and is able to make few transcripts of the LacZYA gene, and this is called basal level of expression, or you can say leaky expression. And this basal level of expression results into the formation of very few molecules of beta-galactosidase and beta-galactoside permease and thiogalactoside transacetylase. So this basal level of expression is very important, because if the cell is starving, there is no glucose present inside the cell, and if lactose is present in the surrounding environment, then the cell has to have beta-galactoside permease in the plasma membrane that will allow the transport of the lactose from the surrounding environment into the cytoplasm of the cell. Okay, and once it enters into the cell, the lactose will get converted into allolactose by the action of beta-galactosidase. Okay, so what does this allolactose do? This allolactose is called the inducer of the lac operon. It goes and binds to the LACI repressor protein. When it goes and binds to the LACI repressor protein, a conformational change takes place in the LACI repressor protein in a way that now it can no longer bind to the operator, and therefore it detaches away. The allolactose can even bind to the free LACI repressor proteins that might be present in the cytoplasm of the cell, thereby bringing about the initiation of transcription of all the structural genes of the lac operon. Okay, and then what happens is, since the transcription has started, more and more beta galactosidase will be produced, more and more beta galactoside permease will also be produced, and therefore more lactose from the surrounding environment will enter the cell. It's like a positive feedback loop. And then the transcription of the LacZYA gene increases tremendously, about 1000-fold than the basal level expression. Okay. Therefore, this lac operon is said to be a negative inducible operon, because it is negatively regulated by the LACI repressor protein, and this repression can be removed. That is, it is de-repressible by the inducer molecule called allolactose. That is, it is an inducible operon. Okay, and one explanation for the basal level of expression of the lac operon, or for that matter any operon, is that when the cell is starving, okay, the ATP to ADP ratio in the cytoplasm will be very less. And we all know that in E. coli cells, the DNA is negatively supercoiled. And the negative supercoiling is brought about by an enzyme which is called DNA gyrase. And it does the supercoiling with the help of ATP molecules. Like, it requires energy to bring about the supercoiling. So if the energy level, or if the cell is starving, the energy levels are very low in the cell, then the supercoiling levels of the DNA will also reduce, and therefore the supercoiling around the operator region will also reduce, and thereby this opening up of the DNA or reduction in the supercoiling of the DNA around the operator weakens the interaction of the LACI repressor with the operator, and therefore it detaches, and this results into basal level of expression of the lac operon. Okay, so if the cell, so it depends upon the energy levels. If the energy, the ATP levels in the cell are very high, then more supercoiling will happen of the DNA, and therefore the more tightly the LACI repressor protein will be bound to the operator, and therefore the basal level expression will be very less in such cell. But as against this, if the cell is starving and the energy is very less in the cell, then the basal level expression of the lac operon in such cells will increase. Another explanation for the basal level of expression is that the LACI repressor protein there are almost around 10 molecules of LACI repressor protein in the cell at any given point of time. And the LACI repressor protein has many non-specific binding sites on the DNA, which are other than the operator. Okay, that is why if all LACI repressor protein binds to non-specific sites or until they find the operator site, the operator will remain unoccupied, and this will result in the basal level of transcription of all of the Lac Operon structural genes from this promoter. Okay, so now I will explain you the detailed structure of Lac repressor protein. It is made up of four subunits. As you can see here in this picture, blue, red, yellow and green are the four subunits of the Lac repressor protein, and all of these four subunits are identical to each other. Therefore, it is called homotetramer. And you can see here that there are two subunits, the blue and the red, which form one dimer over here. And there is another subunit, that is yellow, and another subunit green. Together they form one dimer. Therefore, you can see that the entire molecule as a whole is a dimer of dimers. Okay, this is the N-terminus of the dimer and this is the C-terminus. And as you can see, the N-terminus is bound to the operator DNA, and therefore this is called the DNA binding domain. In the DNA binding domain, each of the subunits have a structural motif which is called the helix-turn-helix motif. This helix-turn-helix motif binds to the DNA, and where does it bind to the DNA? It binds to the operator region. Please remember this, that it binds to the major groove of the operator DNA region. This is asked in many interviews, like if you say that a particular protein is binding to the DNA, the next question that they will ask you exactly where. So you should know whether a protein is binding to the major groove or the minor groove. And here just below it, you have a hinge region, and this also makes contacts with the operator DNA, but it binds to the minor groove. Okay, now the next domain is called the regulatory domain. This is a regulatory domain which binds to allolactose. So as the repressor, say, regulatory domain is bound to the allolactose, the repressor can no longer bind to the operator. And at the end, the C-terminus of each of the subunits consists of an alpha helix, which form the four helix bundle, also called the tetramerization region, which helps the four subunits to be held together. Now, exactly what is the mechanism by which the LACI repressor protein brings about the repression? Okay, so this is the DNA molecule, and here you can see this is the operator and this is the promoter of the LACI operon. And this is the region which is common to both the operator as well as the promoter. And this is a TSS, that is a transcription start set. Now, the LACI repressor is found to bind to three operator sequences called O1, O2 and O3. So, this diagram tells you the positions of these operator sequences in the operator region. So, as you can see, if you go 11 nucleotides towards the right of the transcription start site, that is the plus 11 position, here you will get the O1 operator sequence. If you go 412 nucleotides towards the right of the transcription start site, you have an operator sequence O2 over here. And if you go 82 nucleotides towards the left of the transcription start site, here you have the operator sequence O3. Okay. Now you know that the repressor protein has two DNA binding sites, right? Each of the dimer forms one DNA binding site. Since there are two dimers in the repressor protein, it has two DNA binding sites. Okay, so it is found that out of the two DNA binding sites, one definitely binds to the operator sequence O1. That is, this is the main operator sequence. And the other DNA binding site either binds to O2 or it will bind to O3. So if the two DNA binding sites are binding to O1 and O2, what happens is the DNA region which is present between the O1 and O2 forms a DNA loop. And if the repressor DNA binding sites are bound to O1 and O3, then what happens is the region which is present between O1 and O3 forms a DNA loop. As a result of this, a topological barrier is created by binding of the Lac repressor to the operator, because of which the RNA polymerase cannot bind to the promoter. And this is the mechanism by which LacI repressor protein brings about the repression of the operon. Now, this is the CAP protein. It is an activator of the Lac operon structural genes. CAP stands for Catabolite Activator Protein. This is a protein which binds to a site called the CAP binding site. The CAP binding site is present 61 nucleotides towards the left of the transcription start site. So here you will have the CAP binding site. Okay, but this CAP protein cannot by itself go and bind to the CAP binding site. It requires another molecule which is called the cyclic AMP. When a cyclic AMP binds to the CAP, a conformational change takes place in CAP in a way that it can now go and bind to the CAP activation site. Okay, once it binds here, there is a bend in the DNA which takes place, about 90 degree bend of the DNA which is bound by the CAP takes place. Okay, and this CAP protein leads to the activation of the transcription of the operon genes. How? Because this CAP protein binds to the alpha C terminal domain of the RNA polymerase. So as CAP is bound here, it will make contact with the alpha C terminal domain of the RNA polymerase and allow proper binding of the RNA polymerase to the core promoter region of the promoter, thereby increasing the affinity of the RNA polymerase towards the promoter and initiating efficient transcription from the promoter. Okay. Next. So in the cell, if lactose is present and glucose is absent, then what happens is lactose brings about the induction of the Lac operon genes, or we can say there is removal of the repression which is caused by the LacI repressor protein. However, if glucose is present in the cell and lactose is also present in the cell, even though lactose is present, the Lac operon is not induced, it is still repressed, which means that if glucose is present, the Lac operon induction is inhibited by glucose. Okay, and this phenomena wherein the presence of glucose brings about the inhibition of the genes which are involved in the metabolism of other sugars is called catabolite repression. And this is economical for the cell because glucose, the genes which are required for the metabolism of glucose, are constitutively expressed in the cell. So the cell does not have to spend extra energy in metabolizing glucose. It can directly enter glycolysis and serve as a carbon source for the cell. So now let us see, how is glucose able to inhibit the induction of Lac operon? So when glucose is low, or if glucose is absent in the cell and lactose is present, what happens is cyclic AMP levels in the cytoplasm become high. See, if the cyclic AMP levels become high, it will go and bind to the CAP, which is also called the CRP, that is cyclic AMP receptor protein. And this complex we just now discussed, when it binds to the CAP activation site via this CAP protein, it leads to the activation of the transcription of the Lac operon structural genes. So this is how, in the absence of glucose and in the presence of lactose, there is activation of the transcription of the lac operon which takes place. And you also know that since lactose is present, it will get converted into allolactose, and allolactose will remove the repressor from the operator, okay, and lead to the activation. While if glucose levels, if they are high, what happens is the cyclic AMP becomes, levels go down, okay? That is why the cyclic AMP cap complexes levels will also go down, and that is why if glucose is present in the medium, there is no activation of transcription brought about by this cap protein, because very low levels of cyclic AMP cap complexes are present in the cell. But one might think that since lactose is present in the surrounding, the cell can take up lactose and then bring about the induction of the lac operon by removing the LACI repressor from the operator. But this is also inhibited by glucose. How? By a phenomenon which is called inducer exclusion. As the name suggests, it will exclude, it will not allow the lactose to be transported inside the cell. And it does so by inhibiting beta-galactoside permease. And this entire phenomena is called catabolite repression. So in this way, if glucose is present, due to the cyclic AMP levels being low and inhibition of beta-galactoside permease, the lac operon is repressed. So now we will understand how glucose brings about these two phenomena. So to understand that, first you should know how is glucose taken up by the cell. The E. coli cells are able to do so via a system which is called phosphotransferase system, wherein the glucose, when it is transported into the cell, a phosphate group is added to it, and glucose gets converted into glucose 6-phosphate. And from where does this phosphate comes? This phosphate comes from phosphoenol pyruvate. So this phosphoenol pyruvate will get converted into pyruvate, releasing phosphate. This phosphate will be taken up by E1, that is enzyme 1. Via the enzyme 1, it will go to HPR, which is a heat stable protein. And then via the HPR, it will go to enzyme 2A, which is glucose specific enzyme 2A. Then this E2A will give it to E2B, which will get phosphorylated. Now this E2B phosphorylated will get converted into E2B dephosphorylated by giving this phosphate group to the incoming glucose, converting it into glucose 6-phosphate. Now what do you have to remember from this? This is very important. E2A and the E2A phosphate. The levels of the dephosphorylated form of E2A and the phosphorylated form of E2A is important. So, if the glucose levels are high in the surrounding, more glucose will enter into the cell and will get converted into glucose 6-phosphate. Therefore, E2B phosphate will get converted into E2B. And that is why E2A phosphate will get converted into E2A. So you just need to remember that if more glucose is there, the E2A dephosphorylated form will predominate in the cytoplasm. And if glucose levels are low, since there is no glucose to take away this phosphate, then the E2A phosphate will predominate in the cytoplasm. Okay. So this is what I've written. If glucose levels are high, the E2A dephosphorylated form predominates, and if glucose levels are low, then the E2A phosphorylated form predominates. Now if E2A dephosphorylated form is high in the cytoplasm, this enzyme inhibits an enzyme which is called adenylate cyclase, lactose permease, maltose permease, as well as glycerol kinase. Our interests are the two former ones, that is adenylate cyclase and lactose permease. Adenylate cyclase is an enzyme which brings about the conversion of ATP into cyclic AMP. So if glucose levels are high and E2A dephosphorylated form is there, which is inhibiting adenylate cyclase, then ATP to cyclic AMP conversion will not take place, and therefore in the presence of high glucose levels, cyclic AMP levels go down. Okay. And also this E2A dephosphorylated form is inhibiting lactose permease. Therefore, lactose transport into the cell is blocked. As a result of this, lac operon is repressed in the presence of high glucose levels, which is also known as catabolite repression. And if glucose levels are low, there is no phosphate which is drawn from the E2A. Therefore, the E2A phosphorylated form is predominating in the cytoplasm. And this E2A phosphorylated form brings about the activation of the adenylate cyclase. Therefore, more ATP to cyclic AMP conversion take place. So, the cyclic AMP levels are high. And since there is no inhibition of the lactose permease by E2A phosphorylated form takes place, the lactose input into the cell is also unhindered, and therefore the cyclic AMP cap complexes help in activation of the lac operon, and the lactose which gets imported into the cell gets converted into allolactose, and allolactose brings about the derepression of the lac operon. So I hope you all have understood that the lac operon will be functional, will be expressed only in the presence of lactose and absence of glucose. Both of these conditions need to be fulfilled for the lac operon to be expressed in the cell. Then lac operon is repressed by a repressor protein called the LACI repressor protein. It is induced by the molecule allolactose, which goes and binds to the LACI repressor protein and detaches it from the operator. Then the activator, that is the catabolite activator protein or the CRP, brings about the activation of the genes of the lac operon. And if glucose is present, no activation by the cap will take place, as there is inhibition of the adenylate cyclase. Therefore, the cyclic AMP levels go down, and therefore the cap cannot bring about the activation. And also, since the inducer is excluded, that is, it is not allowed to enter into the cell, there is catabolite repression which takes place in the presence of glucose. And thank you. Please like, share and subscribe to my channel for more conceptual videos.